हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू चैप्टर वन लेक्चर सिक्स. इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट फैक्टर ऑफ सेफ्टी, फैक्टर्स टू बी कंसिडर्ड फॉर सिलेक्शन ऑफ फैक्टर ऑफ सेफ्टी, सिलेक्शन ऑफ फैक्टर ऑफ सेफ्टी, स्ट्रेस कॉन्सेंट्रेशन, कॉजेज ऑफ स्ट्रेस कॉन्सेंट्रेशन एंड मेथड्स टू रिड्यूस स्ट्रेस कॉन्सेंट्रेशन. So we'll start with the first part, that is next factor of safety. Now students, what is factor of safety? As we know that in engineering we are going to design various components. Components are going to be used in various conditions of environment. Properties of the materials are different for different components. So what will happen whenever we are given certain inputs for designing any component? Input will be some technical specifications, load value, stress bearing capacity, material. But over a period of time, that property of the material are changing. Environmental conditions will change. Mode of failure, what we assumed, may also change. And because of all these parameters, our design, whatever we have manufactured or we have done, that design may not be able to survive in the adverse conditions. So keeping that in mind, whenever we are designing component, considering some safety factor, then that safety factor when we are introducing in the design is known as factor of safety. So that factor of safety, when we are considering for design, then our product after manufacturing, when it will be put into use, then definitely it will be surviving more than it needs. And that is known as a factor of safety. Mathematically, we have a definition of factor of safety as it is ratio of maximum stress to working stress or design stress. Factor of safety is also defined for ductile and brittle material. For ductile material, as we know, there is a definite yield point value. So for ductile material, factor of safety is defined as ratio of yield point stress to the working stress. And for brittle material, there is no definite yield point value, but it has ultimate stress because there is no yielding. So for brittle material, factor of safety is defined as the ratio of ultimate stress to working stress. The formula of brittle material is also applicable to ductile material. And all these formulas are applicable for static loading. Now, which are various conditions for selection of factor of safety? As I told you before, that this factor of safety value, how much we will be taking, that depends on various parameters, that what will be the manufacturing method, what is the mode of failure, which type of material is used, types of stresses, what are the environmental and general service conditions, which are various shapes of the parts. So before selecting factor of safety, design engineer must consider few points, and one by one we will discuss all the points in detail. Reliability of properties of the material and change of these properties. Reliability means what? If we have assumed that any material is having certain elasticity value for environmental condition, when that component, when it will be used, put into use, those environmental conditions may change. So property also may change. So considering that variation in the property, because properties are not going to remain constant as per our assumptions, they are likely to change. So how much they are reliable, based on that we have to consider factor of safety. Next is the reliability of test results and its applications. Whenever we conduct any test on any product, you know that results of the test not only depends on the type of the test, but it also depends on the operator who is performing the test. It's also dependent on the accuracy of the measuring instrument. So if there will be error either by the human or in the measuring instruments, our test results are not perfect, and we should not 100% rely on that. There are chances that it may be subjected to changes, and because of that we need to consider factor of safety. Next is the reliability of applied load. That means when we consider 10 kilonewton load for any design, when actual product will be put into use, that load value may little bit increase by some tolerance value. The 10 kilonewton load may vary from 9 or 8 kilonewton to 11 or 12 kilonewton. If we have exactly designed for 10 kilonewton, that definitely it will not be able to withstand 12 kilonewton. So we have to consider how much load may exceed, and based on that we need to consider factor of safety. Next we have, that is the mode of failure. We are not certain about the mode of failure. We may assume that component may fail due to tension, it may fail due to compression, maybe due to shear or bending, but it may happen that other than this assumptions, component may fail due to some other mode of failure. So that we are not certain, in that situation we have to consider factor of safety. In engineering, we know that whenever we are doing any analysis, we normally take assumptions for simplifying. Like there is a twisting moment formula, there are assumptions. In bending moment, there are assumptions. Then Bernoulli's theorem, there are assumptions. These all assumptions we are doing to make our analysis simple. But the moment we take the assumptions to make it simple, for example, we take any product and we say that length of the component is 7 times the diameter. So that is our assumptions. So the more number of assumptions, then design may likely to fail. In that case, we need to consider factor of safety. Then the extent of stresses, the localized stresses, how much they are developing in the component. If its extent is too much, then we need to consider factor of safety. Then during manufacturing, there may be some thermal stresses, or there are some preload stresses developed in the component, initial stresses developed. So those initial stresses, if they are not properly released by some heat treatment processes, then it may be subjected to failure. So there also we need to consider factor of safety. And when our product will be put into use, if it fails, it will cause how many loss of life? That is also one of the important parameter to consider factor of safety. Loss of property also, life and property. For example, crane will fall down in the industry. It will not only create harm to the other equipments which are lying there, it will also create injury to the human being who are working over there. So these two parameters are very important, and seeing all these parameters, we will decide proper factor of safety. So here, which all parameters we will be considering for designing factor of safety or deciding factor of safety? So where we are not sure about the prediction, that what will be the load, strength, wear estimates, environmental effects, and products will be exposed to which all parameters. In that condition, we need to consider factor of safety. Suppose there are components whose failure will result in financial losses, or maybe serious injury like death, or maybe there is a temporary disablement, then factor of safety should be considered between 4 to 4, or maybe even higher, or maybe up to 10. If the component has to last for a lot many years, then factor of safety will be considered more than 5. There are certain situations where we have to consider less factor of safety. For example, component we need to break and take away the energy of the impact, like in case of some components like a shock absorber or maybe some other parts of the cars, there we should consider factor of safety less than 1. There are certain non-critical components, generally factor of safety considered for them will be less than 2. So here we have a table according to which type of load, how much factor of safety should be considered. So it is for static load, variable load and impact load, and the values are given in the table. Next topic for today, it is stress concentration. This is very interesting topic, students. Whenever see there is a machine component which is uniform in cross section, this component is uniform in cross section and these lines are indicating stress distribution lines, and stress distribution is also uniform. But if any component cross sectional area is not uniform but it is abruptly changing, you can see here there is a hole in between, or cross section is abruptly changing, then we can see that the stress distribution lines are not uniform, but it has become non-uniform, it has become discontinuous. So from where the stress distribution becomes discontinuous, there material will be subjected to failure, probability of failure will increase, and this effect is known as stress concentration. So where it will take place, like a components which are having fillets, notches, holes, keyways, spline shafts, where surface roughness is very high, we can say surface smoothness is poor, there are scratch marks, there this stress concentration will be very high. So next we will see the causes of stress concentration. Which are various causes of stress concentration? We have studied the first cause, that is the abrupt change in cross-sectional area, components like stepped axle, keyways, grooves, there we can see there is a sudden change in cross-sectional area, their chances of stress concentration will be high. There are concentrated loads applied at a minimum area of certain part, like when gear teeth are in contact with each other. If it is a spur gear, only maybe one teeth is in contact, full load will come at the contact place, contact surface. So there chances of stress concentration would be high. When mechanical properties of the material vary from time to time, or we can say from point to point, at that time there are chances of failure of a component because of stress concentration. And when in a component surface finishing is very poor, like there are irregularities of the surface finishing, roughness is very high, at that time also there are chances of stress concentration. So next we are going to study today, that is methods to reduce. Yes students, we can reduce the stress concentration, we can't totally neglect, or you can say avoid stress concentration. It is not possible to 100% remove. We can reduce it to certain extent so that chances of failure will decrease. So here we are going to study various methods for reducing stress concentration. First method is, we can provide fillets, undercutting and notches. You can see here this is a stepped component which is subjected to tensile load, and here cross sectional area is suddenly changing. You can see your 90 degree angle, that design is poor. Here we can provide little bit of fillet radius, you can see there is a fillet, and you can say that design is better, so it is good. Instead of that, if we provide a taper like this way, there is a gradual decrement in the cross sectional area, and this design is preferable. You can see distribution of stress is comparatively better. And here fourth, this is the third method, fourth diagram, we can provide some grooves. So here in this diagram, radial grooves are provided in the component, and we can see redistribution of stress, and this design is also preferred. Next component we will see, next method is by providing shoulders in cylindrical members, or maybe in threaded members also, many a times they provide shoulders. Shaft also they provide shoulders. So now that shoulders, why they are providing? Whenever any component is going to be subjected to bending moment, here you can see cross-sectional area is suddenly changing. Fillet radius is too small, then design is poor. Here we have provided radial grooves in the component to improvise the design. And here the grooves are provided in the axial direction also to improvise the design. So this is little better as compared to this design, and this one is the preferred in the industry. Third method to reduce the stress concentration is by providing additional holes. There is a shaft with one hole, and you can see stress distribution is peculiar over here, and to make it uniform adjacent to a single hole, we will be drilling two more small holes. So redistribution of stress lines we will be able to see. So this design is better and preferred as compared to previous one. Fourth method is by changing diameter and length of shank in threads. You can see here this part is known as a shank, and this is a threaded part. Threaded part has two diameters. One is the diameter which passes from the tip, and one which is passing from the trough. Tip is a crest. So this diameter from here to here is a major or nominal diameter, and this diameter is minor or core diameter. When shank diameter is equal to major diameter of threaded parts, then design is poor. What we can do is, up to certain length of the shank, we can reduce the diameter of shank equal to core or root diameter, then design becomes slightly better. Instead of that, if for a entire length of the shank, we reduce the diameter of shank equal to core or root diameter, then design will be far better, which is known as preferred one. Next is method by providing holes in the components with keyway. As we know that keyways we are doing, or we are manufacturing keyways, because whenever there are shafts, shaft will be used to transmit the power, and we are going to mount something on the shaft, maybe gears, maybe flywheel, pulleys, etc. So all those things will be mounted on the shaft with the help of keys. So keyways has to be there. Whenever there is a keyway, because cross-sectional area will suddenly change here, so design of the shaft has become poor. To improve this design, here adjacent to this keyway, we can also drill two small holes, so our design will become better. So students, today I have explained you about factor of safety, selection of factor of safety, criteria for selection of factor of safety, what is stress concentration, causes of stress concentration, methods to reduce stress concentration. Thank you very much. I hope you have enjoyed this lecture.